London, September the 6th, 1978. Keith Moon, drummer with The Who, is guest of honour at a celebrity party hosted by Paul and Linda McCartney. He is 32 years old. But tonight, his Swedish girlfriend at his side, the legendary Wild Man of Rock, is a changed man.
We had a very normal evening. I mean, everybody was surprised. He was the one to come up to me and said, look, darling, I think we're going home now.
12 hours later, in their flat, Annette wakes up to find Keith gone from their bed.
That's when the quietness struck me, a very, very quiet quietness, like the air stood still. And then I knew he was dead before I even went into the bedroom. It just sort of hit me like a, oh, he's gone. That's what it is. So I opened up the bedroom door and I saw his arm hanging over the side. And I turned the light on and I turned him over. He was lying on his stomach. And he was dead.
There are more stories about Keith Moon and his antics on stage and off than about anyone else in rock music. And the amazing thing is, most of them are true. For a man who was famously larger than life, Keith Moon's beginnings were crushingly normal. Born in Wembley in 1946, he was the only son in a respectable working-class family. But from his days at Barham Primary School, Keith always fought to be the centre of attention.
If he had a photograph taken, it was always Moon that was pulling the faces. He had an angelic face that, you know, he thought that anybody would think that butter wouldn't melt in his mouth. He was that type. Oh, not me sort of attitude, you know, and get away with it.
After failing the 11 plus, he went to Alperton Secondary Modern. He seemed to be going nowhere. In art, he was thought retarded artistically, idiotic in other respects. But his music teacher shrewdly observed, he has great ability, but must guard against a tendency to show off. Moon left school aged 15 without taking O-levels.
I don't think anybody expected him to be, you know, as famous as he was. You know, I thought he'd be ending up in prison for stealing cars or things like in that nature. You know, a petty thief.
This early documentary is a rare glimpse of the London and home counties club scene and captures the raw talent emerging in the early mid-60s. It was a breeding ground for future top groups like the Rolling Stones, the Yardbirds, and a little-known band called the Detours, later to become The Who. Roger Daltrey, Pete Townsend and John Entwistle had met at Acton County Grammar School. In 1963, the band hoped to get a record deal, but were told they needed a new drummer. A local club promoter, who later became The Who's official biographer, was Richard Barnes.
They were playing at the Oldfield Club one night, and this is how I remember it anyway, and some drunk guy came up and said, you're looking for a drummer, you know. I got a friend who can play better than that guy, you know, drunk and swaggering and boasting, etc. So they said, well, send him up in the interval, and he can play on one of the numbers. So Keith turned up, looking very, very young.
Keith had been rolled up one day, all ginger all over, ginger shoes, ginger corduroy trousers, ginger jacket, and his hair dyed ginger, holding a glass of brown ale. So his complete ginger sort of vision came up and said, I can play better than him. And this horrible impudent with his hair down like this, and got up on the drummer's drum kit and practically smashed it to pieces. And we thought, this is the man for us.
With Keith Moon at the drums, The Who were transformed. Keith's shotgun drum breaks were a revolutionary new sound. His impact is clearly seen, even in the way this performance of Pete Townshend's Anyway, Anyhow, Anywhere was filmed.
No one ever looked at a drummer, but Moon was almost leading. He was such fierce, driving, sort of ferocious drummer, and all this sort of showing off and acting, that people, you know, he'd become almost the centre of attraction at the back.
He was like a young divine child, you know, he was possessed. Without him, they were so heavy and they were so sort of intense and dark that they probably would have like sunk in some way, you know what I mean? And he was the thing that sort of kept them, you know, alive and floating, you know, like light.
Aged 18, Keith Moon had forced himself onto the lineup of one of Britain's most dynamic new bands. But though he made The Who gel on stage, off stage he remained very uncertain of his place in the group.
In the early days, Keith was very kind of the junior boy. He only first joined. He was all wide-eyed. And he obviously wanted to fit in, and he didn't know, you know, how to get on with the others and stuff like that.
Life on the road is very sort of mindless. And you do have this incredible sort of energy, and you've just done a sort of a long, grueling show. And The Who were always a group who, pretty, I mean, every show was like absolutely the best show ever of their lives. That's how they approached it.
To keep going on the road, they took speed. Amphetamine pills called Purple Hearts. Everyone in the band took them, except Roger Daltrey. But Keith would always go further than the others.
T-class. Before the show, I was talking to Keith, and he said, you know, pardon, dear boy, have you got anything in the upward direction? You know, which is sort of like, what do you mean, anything in the upward direction? I thought, oh, my. So I'd got about 25 Purple Hearts, and I said, well, you know, yeah, have a couple of these. And I remember it now, it's like almost a magic. In one sort of movement, he went, swooped the lot up, and went in his mouth. The lot, 25, I've never taken that many. Just took the lot. It was incredible.
Fueled by Purple Hearts, Keith's onstage performances were electrifying. Here, despite the vacant stare, his drumming remains the engine driving Pete Townshend's My Generation.
He was the energy of The Who. And without that drumming, The Who would not have had that energetic sound. It was always on the edge of your seat sort of music. He used to come off stage completely and utterly drained, and he'd just go and sit in the dressing room and towel over his head, not say a word.
And, as in this interview, he was often barely able to speak.
What's your normal routine after a show like this?
Just leave and get drunk.